I'd like to say good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
What's so happy about?
Being here.
Jesus rose. That's why we're happy.
Right.
If he had not got up out of that grave, guess what? We'd still be lost in our sins.
Amen.
That's why it's happy.
Right.
Our call to worship this morning comes from the Gospel of John. Chapter 20, verses 1 through 9. Gospel of John. Chapter 20, verses 1 through 9. Everyone have it?
Amen.
Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 9. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, into the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. Therefore went forward and that other disciple and came to the sepulchre.
So they ran both together, and the other disciple
did not come near
and came to the
sepulchre. And he stooping down and looking in saw the linen clothes lying, yet went he not in.
Then
came
the disciple did not come near and came into the sepulchre.
And the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Altogether,
for as yet they did not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead.
Amen.
Are you guys?
reading, we're looking at St. John chapter 20. St. John chapter 20. He showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came.
The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord, and mercy has been with him.
With them. Then came Jesus, the door being shut, and stood in the midst and said, peace be unto you. And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God.
Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen me, and they that have believed.
And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, all.
For these are written, that ye might believe that Jesus is Christ, the Son of God, and that believing might have part in his hand.
Amen.
Pray to the Lord, bless the hearers, and we will say,
thank you.
He don't say nothing, but he gets to the words in his mouth.
Yeah.
That's a good one. Blessed, that's the end of the day.
Yeah.
When we both have that deal, we get blessed. We come back with that in COVID or whatever they got going on. Give God, we just keep you praying this moment. Such a week for all that you've given us.
Yeah.
So that we can give back to you. We lift this up, offer up.
Yeah, yeah. He didn't demonize. We're going to have to sing happy birthday, Brother Philo, y'all.
Amen.
All right. Listen, God needs to have some happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Text coming from John chapter 20. John chapter 20. John chapter 20. You get a pretty good synopsis of that resurrection morning or afternoon from that 20th chapter. Today basically starts around verse 27. Then Thomas then said, he too, Thomas, reach hither thy finger and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side. Be not faithless, but believe. Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet believe. For a few minutes I want to talk to myself in faith. And faith fantasy. Faith and faith fantasy. Put forth the notion that Thomas's experience is a dilemma that most saints encounter at one time or another. This matter of faith and faith fantasy. There will be some, I know some of my mentors, they understand they're in heaven, not before they never got there, they might have fussed with them. Because they would suggest that faith is not a fantasy. That writer of Hebrews says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, and the evidence of things not seen. But if you don't see it, you can fantasize about it. And the question that comes to my mind is, how far does your faith fantasies take you as it relates to what God can do in your life? Let's see if a single preacher, somebody ain't there, they came to church anyway. How far does your faith fantasies take you? Because you see, the real problem Thomas had is that he had faith in Jesus. But his faith didn't go far enough. So let me start there talking about a limited Lord. A limited Lord. That the problem Thomas, but not just Thomas, all of them faced, is they limited what Jesus could do. They respected him. They had faith in him. But when news came of his crucifixion, they had problem believing that he had risen. I mean, don't pick on Thomas. I mean, the Bible says he shows himself first to the women. And the women tells the disciples. And when they tell the disciples, they don't believe. That's women talking. You know, women, I'm not a guy. And ladies, you can take rest in knowing that Jesus showed himself first to the ladies. The word was spread by the ladies. How did Mary know? The disciples didn't tell me. The word was spread by the women. And they're in the upper room, and they're not there so much waiting on Jesus. But they've gotten the message he told the women to tell them, meet him at the appointed place. But they're really in the wrong place. But Jesus shows up anyway. But they were really there hiding from the authority. Because they had faith in Jesus, but not enough. Thomas believed the news that Jesus died, but he had a problem believing that Jesus had risen. And I contend, Thomas is not by himself. There are some today who still have a problem believing in what God can do. Like this notion of Resurrection Sunday versus Easter Sunday. You know, some of y'all think Easter is about rabbits and eggs. Have no concept of the idea of this risen Lord. Because you do understand it's a personal thing. It's not just a matter of the 12 and Thomas, it's a matter of you. Because you see, he didn't just rise. The question is, has he risen in your soul? Has he risen in your life? Is he alive for you? Is he just another story? Or he really walks with you and talks with you? Do I have a witness here? Do you limit God in your life? His doubt demanded proof that he had to see with his eyes and feel with his hands. Because his faith went only so far. And, you know, we live in a time now, we kind of believe in logic, They can't see it or touch it. They don't believe it. Got some of y'all in here who's so educated and sophisticated. You got a problem, and don't get me wrong, education is not what causes the problem. You can be as dumb as a donut and still don't believe in the power of Jesus. A lot of y'all believe in the storybook Jesus. You know how to tell a story. You know how, you can tell he died on Calvary Hill early Sunday morning. But when it comes right down to it, you don't really believe God can get some dead situations in your life resurrected. You got a problem. You got a problem when things go bananas in your life, berserk. You can't really trust in the Lord. Don't let things go wrong. Don't let things go left. You're going to trust logic before you trust the Lord. You'll trust security bars before you trust the Lord. You don't trust the Lord to keep your house. It's your security system.
There you go.
this. And I'm concerned that a lot of people are just like Thomas. They limit the Lord. They believe in it so much. And there's nothing wrong with that, because truth of the matter is none of us are where we ought to be.
Yeah.
Truth be told, all of us have some areas of weaknesses, some areas that we need to improve upon. All of us have some areas where we can become spiritually stronger as relates to trusting in God.
Yeah.
Your actions give you away. See, if you really trusted him, there are some things you do you wouldn't do if you really trusted in the Lord.
Yeah.
So, how long is your faith fantasy? In your mind, is there anything too hard for God?
Yeah.
Well, I know the answer. I'm talking about in the deep, deep inner recesses of your soul.
Yeah.
When nobody else is looking.
Right.
And you at home with just you and the Lord.
Yeah.
Is there anything too hard for God? Did God straighten up that hellish woman on the job? God. Get you over drugs? Is there anything too hard for God to be that hard? Next thing I'm going to see before I let y'all go early is a living Lord. A living Lord. Seeing the Lord convinced Thomas that Jesus had risen. But it wasn't enough just to see it. He had to touch it.
Yeah.
And get to see the nail prints.
Right.
Then he was convinced.
Yeah.
The fact that he sees Jesus is because Jesus showed up.
Hmm.
He shows up 8 days later.
Hmm.
He'd already showed up for, they said the 11 is really the 10, because Thomas was absent.
Right.
He walks through the door. And when he shows up, they all scared. But he makes another appearance. You can say he had some other reason, but one of the reasons he showed up was just to let Thomas see him. Well, that's y'all stuff right there. I talked about that before. It gives me courage to know that we serve a Savior that thinks enough of me that he'll show up just for me. Some of y'all are going to come to church, you know, but this, that, and the other. But the good thing about it, Jesus will show up.
I can't
promise you the crowd will show up, but I can promise you Jesus will show up. You can have your doubts and your fears and your failures, but you don't have to worry about that. The Lord will show up. He'll show up. See, you don't have to worry about is Christ alive or not. He will prove his living when he shows up. That's why I don't have to worry about trying to prove to somebody that Jesus is real. All you got to do is let Jesus introduce himself. You're not there trying to introduce Jesus and he can do a better job than you can. But see, the thing is, when he shows up, you better be ready. See, if you ain't ready, if you're not ready, he'll show up and you'll be so scared you'll run in the opposite direction. You have to be ready to receive him, even though he acknowledged Jesus by seeing him and feeling him, he still had a limited view of who Jesus was.
Yeah.
And any limit you place on Jesus
yeah.
is misplaced.
Right.
You Lord and my God. After he felt the hole in his side, my Lord and my God. You might think, okay, how many of you can believe the gossip about the resurrection, but you can't believe the word that he wrote?
Let me get it straight.
See, first of all, y'all need to understand something. They're talking about the disciples, with the link and all that. Y'all heard me talk about it before. First of all, he had the Lord's Supper. Okay? Then the Bible says they marched into the garden. But that was not the Garden of Gethsemane. No, the Garden of Gethsemane is where he took three disciples. Talk to me somebody. Peter, James, and John.
Come on, we're
talking about late night. It could be 10 o'clock or 12 o'clock. The rest of the boys went home. That's what I would do. Went home. They need no supper. They just got to eat the supper. They had more than just a little piece of bread and some wine. They just eat supper. They went home with the bed. He might have kissed his wife when he went to bed. That ain't my business. He went to bed. I'm just sleeping. Okay. Jesus is taken right in the Garden of Gethsemane.
Yeah.
He was asleep. The only people know Jesus was taken was Peter, James, John. The folk who sit for him and the folk who got him.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Then the Bible said he was in. Went from trial to trial. Okay, but he is all during the night. They ain't got no CNN. There's not no local news. You're gonna break in for the emergency broadcast. Ain't no horns and whistles going off. Ain't no alert. No Amber Alert. Your little phone ain't screaming in the island. You just sleep. They when they get through beating him, messing over him, they put him on a cross somewhere around 9 o'clock in the morning. Now most of y'all, especially the retired folk, you still sleep at 9 o'clock in the morning. But even if you got up at 6 or 7 o'clock, you still don't have CNN, no NBC Morning News. So you still don't know what's going on.
Come on, Chris.
He's on the cross from about 9 o'clock in the morning to about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Mine got your attention when the sun stops shining at 12 o'clock noon.
Right. Amen.
That will make a Negro come out of his house. You know how y'all do when the ambulance come out of the house? I see y'all try to ask, y'all know what I'm talking about. When the ambulance, y'all say the ambulance would run down your street. In the morning you hear the siren and everybody run out. That's when my family found out I sleep hard. Because they all talking about the ambulance. They ask, what ambulance? They mean everybody talks about everybody. And I step straight through. Well. They still don't know what's going on. He's crucified and just about put in the grave before the word gets out.
Yeah.
He rises from the grave Sunday morning. The first one who saw him was Mary Magdalene.
Right.
Mary Magdalene tells the women tell that you know Mary. She told the first people Mary contacted was Peter and John.
Right.
Not only disciple, but the one. The only disciple that was there at the cross was John. And when Mary got word, when she talked to him, she runs to tell Peter. Not running to tell John. She's running to tell Peter. When she runs to tell Peter, John is there. That's a sermon right there. The one man that's there at the cross is at the man who denied him house. See, sometimes instead of gossiping on folk, you ought to be trying to make them stronger. Amen. Could have tried to drive them away, or to be trying to draw them closer.
Amen.
And so Thomas is back for everybody else. Thomas doesn't really know what's going on until they tell him. So everything he receives is secondhand. Question: why is it I have no problem believing Jesus is crucified, but I got a problem believing he has risen from the dead? Crucifixion is the worst kind of death anybody could possibly have.
Yes.
It was reserved for criminals, the lowlife.
Yes.
Why is it you had no problem believing that this Jesus qualified for such a humiliating death, but you got a problem believing that he rose from the dead? I keep hammering the point, because we have a human nature. We have no problem believing the messy stuff.
All right.
We have no problem believing the dirt. We have no problem believing that people messed up. But we have difficulty having faith in the power of people to rise above their circumstances.
Yeah.
Oh! Why is it I can believe the weakness, but I can't believe the strength?
Right.
Why I can believe the wrong and I can't believe the right? And anybody ought to be able to testify. It ought to be the men closest to him.
Yeah.
If anybody can testify about his character, his integrity, it ought to be the one that spent the most time with him.
Right. Come on.
But you'll find in life that some of the first suckers who really talk about you are the ones who are closest to you.
Yeah.
The only ones who are ready to drag you down are the ones who know you best.
Yeah.
And when folk look to you for a positive comment, all they're getting is the negative stuff. Well, I know it's right, because J.P. said that. He with him all the time. A word is only as good as the person who's uttering the word.
Yeah.
And if you don't have a word, your word don't really mean anything. If you don't have a word, your word don't mean anything. People shake their head. You know, some folks don't have any confidence in what you say because you lie all the time.
Well.
I deal with my preacher because he likes to play. Tell him, you my best cousin. Huh? But see, you got to be careful with all that kind of mess. Because see, you don't want folk to say that you lie more than you tell the truth. It's like the boy who hollered wolf.
Yeah.
When you holler wolf, when there's not a wolf, when it's time to sound the alarm, nobody believes. Thomas had a problem, but don't get me wrong, he wasn't the only one. All of them had the same problem.
Amen.
John was right there at the cross. And it's not really any indication that John was any more believing than anybody else.
Yeah.
When it came to resurrection news.
Yeah.
Bible says when Mary Magdalene came to get him, he outruns Mary and Peter. But he wouldn't go inside. He waited till Peter got there.
Yeah.
Peter went in. And when they went in, I tell you, that's the sermon right there. When they went in, what they saw, they didn't see Jesus. Jesus was gone. All they saw was the wrappings, the rags they used to wrap Jesus in.
Yeah.
You say, but see, the sight was, it wasn't that some rags folded up and laid down on top of his back. It said the rags were rolled in the shape of a body. But there was no body in the rags. That's another sign. Let me close then by talking about this liberating law. Had Thomas not missed the first meeting, he might have been in better shape all along.
Right.
you know me, I'm a proponent of coming to church. But you got to be careful when you miss church. When you miss something you can't ever regain.
Yeah.
We were climbing with Donnie, Donnie in the study. Donnie wasn't here last Sunday. We were telling Donnie that you missed it. Old Big Mike sung his song last Sunday. Mike called everybody telling him he gonna sing a solo again. He worried Sam Freeman so much, Sam Freeman missed going to his church and came over there. Just to hear Mike sing. But now, when you heard Mike sing, I punched Freeman. I said, boy, don't you think it was worth coming out here? Yeah, it was worth coming out here. Mike stole the show last Sunday. Mike took us to another level. The Lord used Mike in a special way. That if you missed it, you really missed something.
Yeah.
Well, no, Donnie said, I missed it. Old Mike gonna try to pull it up on his phone. Mike pulled it on the phone. And Donnie was like, I didn't say anything. Because even though you go home right now and pull it up on your phone or your computer, it is not the same as being in the service. You can't feel what we felt. You can't know what we do. God used my last Sunday in a special way to bless all of us. But now, one of the reasons I was blessed and a lot of folk in here is that I was praying for Mike, that God would use Mike in a special way.
All right.
And when you see God answering your prayer,
Come
on here, somebody. That you be a good answer. If you see God taking him up, he can't take him higher without taking you higher.
Yeah.
That's what real worship is all about. You're not selfish about it. You don't get jealous when God uses somebody else, because you pray that God used them anyway.
Yeah.
When you pray for God to use them, you know that God is using you.
Yeah.
Do I have a witness here?
Yeah.
Well, my brothers and sisters, this matter of this living Lord. Said faith is one thing, but faith after the facts is really faithless. Thomas, you believe because you've seen. You believe because you put your finger in my side. But blessed are those who believe and they didn't see anything. Do I have a witness here? Thomas didn't make first church, but don't let the fact you missed last Sunday stop you from going next Sunday. Do I have a witness here? See, the devil likes to make you think because you missed last week, you can't go next week. Because too many people going to ask you where you been. Instead of you asking where they been, you ought to be saying, I'm so glad to see you today. When you ask them what's wrong, you ought to be saying what's right. This liberating Lord is where I close. I've used that before, but it fits this morning because Jesus is here liberating everybody he met. Take my word for it. Read the stories again. There's nowhere in Scripture that Jesus met anybody and he started fussing at them. For what they didn't do. Wish I had a witness.
Yeah.
I don't see where he fussed at Peter for denying him. When he shows up and walked through that door while the door is still closed, and those 10 disciples are there, most of them were not at the cross. But I don't see him fussing about their absence. The women told him that he had risen. They didn't believe it. I don't see him fussing about their unbelief.
No,
the Bible said when he showed up, the first thing he said is, peace be unto you. I wish I had a witness here. Yeah, he said, peace be unto you. And he didn't say it once, but he said it twice.
Yeah.
Y'all didn't believe me. Look at verse 19. He says, he's in the midst of them and said, peace be unto you. Go down to verse 21. Then said Jesus unto them again, peace be unto you. As my Father have sent you, even so I send you.
Yeah.
I wish I had a witness here. He said, peace be unto you. He doesn't talk about their mess ups. He doesn't talk about where they fell short. He says, all I'm doing is trying to bring peace into your life.
Yeah,
you need to understand that we are at peace because Jesus is the one who brings us peace.
Yeah,
when you meditate over your faults and your failures, God don't have a lot to do with that. That ain't nothing but the devil trying to pull you down.
Yeah.
I wish I had a witness here. When Jesus showed up, he said, peace be unto you.
Yeah.
And then if that wasn't enough, he said it twice. The Bible said he blew on them. And then he had nerve enough to say after he blew on them, receive the Holy Ghost. Oh, y'all ain't getting this. This is shout stuff right here. Yeah, the Bible said in Acts, when he told them to wait until, the Comforter comes. The Bible said all they heard was a mighty rushing wind. But this ain't Acts yet. We still in John. And the Bible said Jesus made his own wind. And he said, oh, Mr. God, well, my brothers and my sisters, seem like to me Jesus is giving them a foretaste about what's going to occur on Pentecost. One writer said they didn't receive the Spirit. He's just being symbolic. I said, no. You got to understand that Jesus don't play in symbols when it comes to the Holy Ghost. The Bible said he breathed on them. And he did. He said, receive the Holy Spirit. Well, my brothers and sisters, you missed it. He said, whosoever, sin you remit, they will stay remitted. And whoever your sins you retain, they will be retained. In other words, he said, as my Father sent me, I also send you.
Yeah,
oh, I wish I had a witness here. They've been messing up. They've been denying. They feel unworthy and unqualified. And here comes Jesus breathing on them and saying, receive the Holy Ghost. But he said, just like the Father sent me, I'm sending you. But I'm not sending you like the Father is sending you. I'm sending you under the anointing the Father has already given unto me. And what the Father sent me to do, you are an extension of me, and receive the Holy Ghost. Y'all still don't get it. What Jesus is trying to tell them, and he's also trying to tell us, is that don't be discouraged when you let yourself down. Because you see, whenever you're depending on you to make it, you will always disappoint yourself. Whenever you're trying to do it with your own strength, you'll always fall short. But I hear him saying, the Comforter, he's going to come in and dwell you. But for right now, I'm going to give you some temporary empowerment. Receive the Holy Ghost so that you can look at yourself the way I see you. You see, when Jesus looks at us, he don't see our past mess-ups. But when Jesus looks at us, he sees our future victories. When Jesus looks at us, he doesn't see our past failures and faults. When he looks at us, he sees our future victories. And he said to them, receive the Holy Ghost, because you can't see right on your own. Your vision is blurred because the devil keeps trying to block your eyesight. The devil tries to mess up your faith fantasies. The devil keeps trying to plant God in your mind so you can't get to the level that God wants you to get to, but receive the Holy Ghost. And when you receive the Holy Ghost, he'll blow all of the doubt out of your way. He'll blow the dust from your eyes. He'll clear up your spiritual vision so you can have a spiritual 2020 and see like Jesus sees and walk like Jesus walked and talk like Jesus talked. When Jesus let his Holy Ghost come in, the same that denied me three times preach on Pentecostal Sunday and tell somebody the same Jesus, the same Jesus that you crucified, he's alive and he's doing very well. The same James, we don't know what happened to him, but he's the first one to die, but he didn't die like a coward, he died. In chapter 11, he says, let's go with him and die, because he thought when Jesus returned to Galilee, they were going to crucify him in Jerusalem. But I'm so glad he was a brave man, but he had the wrong conclusion. He said, I want you to see the end, and when you see the end, you'll know that it's all right. We've been making do for night, but joy comes in the morning. Some of y'all don't understand. Well, if you get a book, instead of reading all the book, you will go to the end to see how it comes out first. And then you start reading the book. They'll tell you, we don't want to give away no spoilers. You tell folk, yes, I got some old football games. Every now and then I pull one up and I look at it. I know what the score's going to be at the end, but I still want to look at the play-by-play. But there's a difference when you know how it's going to come out and when you don't know how it's going to come out. You see, when you don't know how it's coming out, when somebody fumbles, you get all flustered and stressed. When somebody messes up, you get all mad and disgusted. But when you know they're going to win in the end, they can fumble, but it don't mean a thing. They can throw an interception. It doesn't bother you. Because I know if you're fast forward, we're going to win the victory. I came by to say, Jesus said, receive the Holy Spirit, and you'll be able to see the end. Thomas, you believe because you can see. But faith is not about what you can see. It's about what you can't see. If you want to get to a higher level, you got to get the Holy Ghost, who will give you some faith and some real good faith fantasies. You see, when I trust in God, I know he can do anything. When I trust in God, I believe he can do the impossible. When I trust in God, I believe he can heal cancer. He can heal COVID-19. When I trust in God, I believe he can do the impossible. Some of y'all are looking at me, you don't know what I'm talking about, but if you receive the Holy Spirit, he will take you to another level. Something happened.
Thank you.
you again for this worship experience and for manifestation of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for all these who have assembled, and we are cognizant of your request that we show forth your death and suffering until you return by participating in this supper. Even though it's 12 o'clock noon, we call it supper because it's your body and your blood. We call it supper because it's at the end of the day, when Satan lost, you won. So, Master, we pray that you would help us to examine our hearts and remove those things that are hindering us. Confess our sins right now, and that you have with them, but most importantly, that we would dwell in the body of you, Christ. When you hung on Calvary, you took on my sins and the sins of the world, bruised by our iniquities and transgressions. You were beaten and mistreated because of our mess ups. So, Master, we come now wanting to take on your body and drink your blood, that we may again be walking manifestations of you, an extension of you, you and your ministry. Take on these symbols, Lord. We pray that your Holy Spirit will again touch our hearts and empower us for service. Take us to a higher level, we ask and pray. We ask it in Jesus' name, for his sake. The church said amen.
Amen.
We ask that those in the balcony, if you come down first and receive your communion. Come on, gentlemen, don't stop, man. Don't stop. Cut the mic. Don't let it get in the way. Got to put the material
off. Thank you.
benediction for everybody. Come on, give me a benediction.
Lord, we thank you for the word that's out of the room preached, Father. We thank you for the Son, Father. Because without you, we wouldn't be here, Father. We thank you for being who you are, Lord. We thank you for the preacher, Father God. We ask you to continue to use our pastor, Father God.